So this is what I'm going to be talking about, signals and noise and other physiological signals, brief history of EEG and how the EEG is generated and the waveforms. And then I'll be spending most of the time on general abnormal, on normal abnormal and what else is there in the report. And finally, a few words on the utility of EEG in clinical diagnosis. So the first part depends on is actually takes us further to signal processing and all. I'm not going to go into the details of filters and of amplifiers and all, but if somebody is interested, I can take that separately. Okay. So signals and noise. So signal is any any type. Physiological can be from the neuraxis as well, and we know that it can be from the heart as well, and almost anywhere. So the neurophysiological activity of interest in the EEG is of course the electrical activity, and what we are measuring is potential difference, and this potential difference is fluctuating. And what is the source of the signal? It's a pool of neurons which are oriented appropriately and with synchronous fluctuations of potentials. We are not reading one neuron. We are reading a large area of multiple neurons. In fact, millions of neurons together, we will give rise to what we see on the one channel of the EEG along one electrode. And what is noise? Noise is everything else. Things that we are not interested in, and which could be from within the body or from outside the body. And from within the body, it could be other signals which can come from the muscle, it can come from movement that we make, it can come from the cardiac conducting system also, right up to the head, right? And can come from outside the body, these electrostatic signals our AC current, alternating current, which also fluctuates at 60 hertz, can also give rise to variations. So what we are interested in, therefore, is the signal noise ratio. We want to improve the signal while reducing the noise as far as possible. And when we talk of high fidelity system, what we mean is that the output is as close or as faithful to the input. Why does the output change as in relation to the input? Because whenever we are trying to improve the signal and reduce the noise, we are doing some modifications, and those modifications will change the output in some way or the other. And that is why a little bit of understanding of what we are doing to the signal is important when we are trying to interpret the output. So reducing noise can be by several methods. The most important things are filters and amplifiers, and these are the things that I am not going to go into detail right now. Other physiological signals, we're all familiar with ECG, and we know them, the electrode, the numbers, we talk about the placement, we talk about volume conduction also in ECG, because we put the electrodes over here and the electrode over here is picking up the signal change that is taking place at the proximal arm. So that is the concept of volume conduction, because the body is a volume conductor because of the large number of ions. So it is able to, we are able to find by recording at the surface far away also what a signal that is going on elsewhere. We talk about channels, we talk about montages. Montage in EEG is very important. In ECG it is not important because we have the two planes alone. The size of the signal is important. Size of the signal in ECG is in millivolts, in EEG it is in microvolts. We talk about waveforms and time intervals, we talk about the vectors and the vector magnitude as well, which gives us tells us which muscles are likely to be hypertrophied and all, right? With comparison with the imaging as well, imaging is also in a way signals, but except that imaging gives us good spatial resolution. It tells us about space, about how things are located in space, whereas EEG and ECG and all tell us about with relation to time, what is happening with time. So, but the EEG is not very good at spatial resolution. It is very good at temporal resolution. So EEG and imaging complement each other, but they cannot replace each other. regarding the history of the EEG, the person who is most famous for the first human EEG is Hans Berger. He was a German psychiatrist. He was not a neurophysician, and what he was interested in the brain waves was more in terms of telepathy and those kind of things was his area of interest. These are the books that he wrote. This is in the turn of the century. It was in the late 1920s that he worked on EEG, and he died during the Second World War in 1941. He was a University of Jena, and he was a very meticulous person. So he was able to, you know, document all his things very nicely, and that was the main thing that he was able, because in those days the galvanometers were very primitive, so it required very difficult procedures to be able to just get one waveform from the scalp of his his own son, and he wrote some 14 reports. He was an aloof patient, not very, you know, showy, so he didn't actually become famous. The person who made him famous was Adrian, and he confirmed Berger's findings. We don't hear so much of Adrian now. Hans Berger is the more famous person, but this is the man who brought Hans Berger to limelight. And in the 1930s, around the same time, Lennox and Gibbs were the people who traveled to Germany and spent time with Hans Berger to be able to work on this. And they came back to, Lennox went back to Boston and Gibbs to Chicago. And they were the ones who took EEG further. And we have a connection with Gibbs. The person who started EEG in Vellore in the early 1950s, 1951, was a person known as Baldev Singh. He is also known as the father of Indian neurology. He was the one who started the Department of Neurology in All India Institute. Subsequently, he worked for 3 years in Vellore at the age of 40, in the late 40s, early 50s. And he was called back by Dr. Jacob Chande, because he worked with Gibbs, and when he was looking for a place to come back to India, he was from Amritsar. There was no place for him. And Dr. Jacob Chande, with foresight, had asked him to come and work with him. And he worked in Vellore for 3 years before he went back to Lady Harding. And then finally he set up the Department of Neurology. By that time he was beyond 60 when he started neurology in All India Institute. Gibbs had worked with Albert Grass, who was with the Mass Institute of Technology, and they created the first commercial EEG machines, and the first machine in Vellore in the 1951 was a Grass machine. So that's the other Vellore connection. So we have some history with EEG. Going to generation of EEGs, obviously we have a waveform. So this also I'm not going to go into the details of the mathematics behind the sine waveform, Fourier transforms and all that. Manoj has been attending some signal processing classes with us that can be a different discussion. But basically what we are doing is we are looking at it on a visual format with time on the x-axis and potential difference, which is the voltage, on the y-axis. And there are certain signals that we interpret by auditory format, which is by hearing, and that is EMG. So when you put a needle EMG, we don't only look at the vision, we actually give more importance to hearing. So that's why you'll hear about the dive bomber sound when we put a needle EMG into the muscle, somebody who has got myotonia. So there are descriptions from the World War era. So the dive bomber sound. So what EEG is all visual format. And time is on the x-axis and amplitude is on the y-axis. Amplitude is potential difference, and in the case of EEG, we are measuring in microvolt. So this electrical activity is obviously coming from the cortex. Yeah. Electrical activity in the cortex, we know, could be from the membrane potential, action potential, synaptic transmission and postsynaptic potentials. So when we didn't know, there was a lot of discussion on what could be the source of the electrical activity that we are measuring in the EEG. Hans Berger did not know what he was actually measuring in terms. So these are things that we found out much later. It is actually the postsynaptic potentials which we are measuring. So over here, so these postsynaptic potentials tend to keep fluctuating. When they summate, they can give rise to an action potential. So it is not the action potentials that we are measuring in the EEG. What we are seeing in the EEG is the postsynaptic potentials. And how does that happen? We know that the in the cortex has a columnar arrangement, and this columnar arrangement is very useful. So when these postsynaptic potentials fluctuate with the synapses, so these are the dendrites. So when there is a depolarization occurs, these surface becomes negative at that location, and another location along the dendrite is relatively positive. So you have a combination of negative and positive that becomes a dipole. If multiple neurons are this is happening at the same time, you have a pool of neurons where negative and positive dipoles have been created. If all of them are oriented in the same place, you will see a change in the electrode on the scalp. It's actually as simple as that. And this configuration is most important for generating the dipole flow. So this is what it looks like. So the axon is going downwards, which is going all the way down from the corticospinal tract. But the cell body is of course lying in layer 5. These are the Betz cells. And it goes upwards towards the layer 1. And these large dendrites have got multiple connections. And these axons which are coming from the thalamus could either end at the proximal part of the dendrite, or it could end at the distal part of the dendrite. Depending on that, you can see that there will be fluctuation. So there is always what we call as thalamocortical connections, which are fluctuating and which are giving rise to the waveforms that we are seeing on the EEG. So this is in normal and also in sleep. In sleep, the EEG becomes more synchronized because the thalamocortical connections become stronger till REM sleep. In REM sleep, again, it becomes desynchronized. So the EEG results from a combined activity of large numbers of similarly oriented pyramidal neurons and requires synchronous activity across several groups. It has been calculated that for one electrode, if to see some activity, we need about 6 centimeters square of scalp area to be able to see it as a single waveform. So it is the summed postsynaptic activity of large cell collections. And this is, and it's, so when we talk of a dipole, it is actually, there are multiple dipoles within which are summated, and what we are seeing as a single waveform, which will be different in different parts of the brain. And obviously, just like any other thing, this is also ultimately it's a vector, so it has got a direction as well. And what we are measuring on EEG is the radial component. There's another form of magnetoencephalography. It's called magnetoencephalography, where we can look at tangential as well as radial components. So now, how is it different from ECG in terms of source of the signal interest? In the cardiac, it is fairly simple. It is going from the SA node to the AV node, and then the bundle of His and spreading along the ventricles. It has got its own way. So how it is traveling, we are measuring at different points of time, and we get the complexes that we see. And we use different channels to be able to look at it from different viewpoints to be able to figure out what all is going on. So there's certain questions can be answered. In EEG, there are innumerable number of possible sources of electrical activity. So that also is an important thing. The sources of the signal of interest are also multiple. So now just to introduce you to what we are collecting. So like in ECG, we have the limb leads, and then we have the 6 chest leads. And then we combine them. You know, of course, that the AVR, AVL, AVF is by combining 2 and then against 1. So what we are doing in the EEG is we have certain landmarks. This is the 10-20 system. There is another system called as 10-10 system, which is used for epilepsy surgery and all. But for the basic routine EEG is the 10-20 system. It means nothing but that. From the nasion till the ineon, these electrodes are either 10% or 20% of the total distance, and we keep putting them backwards, and we label them according to like the frontopolar is called FP, frontal is called F, C is central, P is parietal, and O is occipital, and T is temporal. So we have a naming system, the even numbers on the right side, odd numbers on the left side, and we label the ear as well because we use it for reference, so A1 and A2. All right. and this is a more simplified version, and we can connect them in different ways. If we connect them from FP2 to F8, remember potential difference is always a difference between two. So if we are looking at the difference between FP2 to F8, then this becomes one channel, and if we arrange them in such a way that we are looking at first channel is FP2 to F8, then second channel is F8 to T8, third channel is T8 to P. So this is how we are connecting. This is known as a bipolar montage. So we are just collecting one after the other along the scalp. The other way to do it is that we connect all of them to, say, an ear electrode. It can be actually anywhere. We have any number of possible permutations and combinations we can do for this. But this kind of thing where all of them on one side are going to one reference is called as a referential montage. So these terms you'll hear about. But when you're looking at the EEG output, what we are looking at in terms of normal and we discuss is in terms of age, what is the state, are they awake or asleep, drowsy, awake, relaxed, awake with eyes open, awake with eyes closed. And then we do some normal, usual activation procedures during a routine EEG, which is photic stimulation and hyperventilation. The variations that we get from the normal can be in the background, which is the EEG as a whole. So the EEG certain parts of the EEG or the EEG as a whole may become slower than what was expected for that age, for that state, or for that activation, or it can be faster, or you can see some periodic patterns. Transients can be either artifacts, or they can be benign variants, or there can be actual interictal epileptiform discharges. Transient means a brief activity which comes for a short period of time. And then of course we can have EEG seizures, where we can actually track a seizure as it is taking place along various electrodes, how it spreads from one place to another. Okay, so these are the basic variations that we are looking for when we are doing an EEG. This is also very different from ECG, where we have multiple types of artifacts and several benign variants. And if you're not familiar with them, we may tend to over-report. So this is also one thing to keep in mind. That's what makes EEG reporting a little bit more complicated, much more complicated than, say, ECG. So this is just a page, just to again give an idea. So we're seeing a page. How many channels are there on this page? 9 channels, no? 4 plus 4 plus 1. There are 9 channels on this page. What's on the x-axis and the y-axis? X-axis is time, right? Y-axis is amplitude potential difference. And you're seeing that the 4th and the 8th channel in the first few seconds have got a higher amplitude, right? Okay. How many seconds are there? Each of these is 1 second from one blue line to the other. So how many seconds are there? Just over 10 seconds in this page. What is on each channel? If you want to know, we have to look closely at the first line. So a little bigger if you were to see it, this is what it looks like. So it will be written over there, FP1, F3, F3, C3, C3, P3. So like that it will be written over there. So what each channel represents. So over here what we have is FP1 to F3, F3 to C3, C3 to P3, P3 to O1. Similarly, this is so the odd numbers are on the left, even numbers on the right. So we have a right, we have a left central followed by a right central. And the last one of course is the ECG, or what the EEG people like to call the ECG as EKG. Anyway, so and going back to this, what we are looking at is this. So this is a FP1 to F3, F3 to C3, C3 to P3. So this is one arrangement, and this is the first four, and the next four were on the right side, this paracentral chain of electrodes. Okay, now if you look at it, what is the difference between the first 5 seconds and the rest, the remaining 5 seconds? Something has changed, right? So one is that this activity in the, what electrodes were these? These were the P3O1 and the P4O2. These electrodes are showing some activity which has disappeared at this point of time, right? So why would it have disappeared? So basically what has happened is that this is the first 5 seconds, the patient or the person is lying, is awake, lying comfortably with eyes closed. At the 6th second, the person has opened the eyes. Opening the eyes attenuates this activity in the occipital lobe. Why is that? So the visual is coming over there. So just by looking at this EEG, we can make out some behavioral changes. But there are some other things also that we can make out. So in this page, we are seeing this activity over here. This is actually eye blinks. The patient is blinking the eye. So what happens when you blink the eye? When the eye closes, the eyeball moves up because of the Bell's phenomenon. So when the eyeball moves up, the cornea, which is relatively positive as compared to the retina and functions like a dipole, moves up. So when the cornea comes closer to the FP1 electrode, the FP1 electrode becomes relatively more positive as compared to the electrode behind. All right. So why does the blink go downwards? Because the cornea is moving upwards. And if we see over here, in that particular sequence, so FP2 to F8. So if the cornea comes closer to FP2, FP2 will be relatively more positive than F8 for the duration of time that it is moving forwards. So the FP2 becomes relatively more positive, and by convention, if you are connecting FP2 to F8, FP2 on the positive and F8 on the negative, what we see is a downward deflection. It's called as a positive wave, but it's a downward deflection that we see on the EEG output. So this is direct versus alternating current. The eyeball dipole functions like a direct current. It is seen on the EEG only when the eyeball is moving. Otherwise, we don't see it on the EEG. So eye blinks is direct current, and most of the activity of the brain is actually like alternating current. So because these postsynaptic potentials are fluctuating in the cortex, and the rate of fluctuation and the location of fluctuation depends on the connections of that area to the thalamus and what rate it is going at that particular point of time. So this is similar. What do you think is happening over here? So these are FP2, F8, F8, T4, and these two are FP1, F7, and F7, T3. So over here, unlike the previous one where both of them were going down, over here one is going, they're going away from each other at this point, and the common electrode is F8. So something is happening at F8, and both of them are going away from each other. And at F7, what is happening? They're coming towards each other. So if you go again by a simple thing, so what is happening is there is a positivity taking place at F8 and a negativity taking place at F7 at this point of time, in this second, right? So what does it mean on the EEG? This F8 is becoming relatively positive, F7 is becoming relatively negative, F8 is more positive than FP2 also. And F8 is more positive than T4 also. That is why we are seeing it as moving away from each other. So what does it mean? What has happened over here in that particular EEG? What is happening? So eye blink was when the eyeball moved up. What is happening over here? The eyeball has moved to the side. Right? Eyeball has moved to F8 because the cornea is relatively positive. It has moved to F8. So what we're seeing activity in F8 is going away from each other. So it's actually fairly simple things which needs to be incorporated when we're reading this. So it becomes, so as we keep doing this, we start being able to predict by looking at just a page what is actually happening, not only in the brain, but even on the surface, even on the what the person is doing. So this is lateral eye movement, so towards the right or left. FP2, this is an even number, so towards the right. So this is eyeball has moved towards the right. And that is why F7 has become relatively negative. Okay, so this looks abnormal, right? For the several seconds, we've got some activity in the front. What do you think it is? It's written in the bottom. This is eyelid fluttering, right? I'm just showing this to show you how easy it is to mistake an EEG as normal, EEG as abnormal. So this is just an eyelid fluttering. Similarly, we have on ECG, patients with Parkinson's, the ECG can look like a atrial flutter. You've seen that? So those kind of things can happen because of the tremor. So over here is the eyelid fluttering, which can look like a frontal dominant generalized discharge. All right. Over here, what is happening is that the patient is slightly becoming drowsy. Are you able to see a difference between the initial, so this is not as dramatic as the page that I showed you earlier, but there is a difference between the initial few seconds and the later few seconds. What is the difference? it is slowing down. Yeah, it is slowing down. You can see that this part is slowing down. So the activity was faster over here and is slowing down. So the person is becoming slightly drowsy. If you see this transition, there are many other ways also which we can use. So over here, this is again another page, but you're seeing multiple channels over here. How many channels are there? 4 into 5, 20 plus 1 ECG channel. So that's 21 channels over here. The first four are, if you're not able to see it, I put it up. So these are the first four, the left temporal channels. These are left temporal. Next four are left central. Then we have four which are midline. These are denoted as Z channels. Then we have the right central and the right temporal. And over here, we are seeing something abnormal over here. We're seeing a small spike over here. So where is the maximum negativity of the spike discharge? It's at this location, right? This is where maximum negativity means that the activity is pointing towards positivity, will goes away, negativity will comes towards each other, which we also call as phase reversals. And over here, the maximum negativity is at this point, and therefore the common channel to these two electrodes is F8. So the maximum negativity underlying F8. So F8 is where this spike is coming from. But you can see that it is falling off. So there is a large waveform even on T8P8, between the temporal and parietal. This is right temporal. So which tells us that there is a significant difference between T8 and P8 as well. And between P8 and O2, the difference is less. So therefore the amplitude is less, right? So the maximum abnormality is in F8. F8, though it is labeled as frontal, it is actually also anterior temporal. So this patient has a right anterior temporal spike. Now that alone could be important, but we are seeing something else on another page of the same patient. Can you make out anything different over here? If you look closely, you will find that the same temporal ones briefly over here have become slower than the other side. So this is the left temporal and this is the right temporal, and we are seeing slowing over here, and this slowing is in the delta range. So when we talk of waveforms, we have this thing about alpha, beta, theta and delta. So delta is the slowest, delta is the slowest, theta is a little slower. So delta is the slowest at around 0 to 3 per second. Theta is 4 to 7 per second hertz. And then alpha is 8 to 12, and anything more than 12, 13 to 17 is called as beta. So beta is the fastest, and alpha is the range that we usually get in the occipital lobe, or what we call as a posterior dominant rhythm, in an awake patient who is lying down comfortably with his eyes closed. All right. So over here we don't know the state of this patient, but intermittently there is some slowing coming in this right temporal region, and this also is significant. We call it as, in fact, temporal intermittent rhythmic delta activity, TERDA it's called, and this also has as much significance as the spike waves that we're seeing over there. Okay, so you will have understood that we are looking at the amplitude and we are looking at the location, and therefore it is actually somewhat similar to how we calculate the epicenter of an earthquake as well. So we need at least three locations, and in the EEG we are doing multiple locations, and we can see how it is falling off. What is the difference between this connection to the next connection to the next connection, and what is the difference between them? We can actually put mathematical numbers over there and say that where is the maximum negativity and how much it is different. So the epicenter can be a very small one, the focus, or it could be a large one also. Even that information we can get by just looking a little closer at the EEG. So this kind of thing becomes natural when we are reading EEG frequently. But I just want to give you an example of how, when you are asking for an EEG, what all things we are actually getting, and how easy it is to get carried away by seeing what appears abnormal. So over here, what we are seeing is, again, at F8, which is the common electrode over here, we are seeing maximum negativity. And this we also call as phase reversal. So it was a downward over here and becomes upward over here. So a phase reversal with maximum negativity at F8 implies that this spike is coming from F8. Okay, this is a similar one where we are seeing some activity on the, this is the left side and this is the right side, temporal. Is this normal? This actually is absolutely normal. This activity is called as wicket spikes. So how do we differentiate between that? Over here, a little bit of the fall off thing comes in, comes into calculation, and also because it is bilateral, it is not standing out completely, and the particular pattern that is given. So these are normal activity in the, because under ordinary circumstances, or some of the other activities always going on the brain. Right, so this is normal, and but can be easily read as spikes in the temporal. So when you are seeing an EEG report from outside, you have to be very careful, because they'll report anything can be reported as dysrhythmia. So the general principle is that if there is a doubt, under report. Over here we are seeing some abnormality in this location over here. This is a muscle artifact, because it is very high frequency, the muscle, just like an EMG. We put an EMG muscle needle into the muscle, and what we're reading, it's something like that we're recording from the surface electrode. So it's a muscle artifact. Where is it coming from? You may not be able to read this. It's F7, T3, T3, T5. So it's coming from the temporal side. So which muscle is it likely to be coming from? The left temporalis muscle. So you know, you can actually do a lot of looking at this. So the person is probably slightly clenching his teeth. So by looking at EEG, you can even make out if the person is anxious or relaxed or so. The, so this also is same thing, but he stopped in between. So this can look like a run of spikes, easily interpreted as abnormal. This is also something similar, but it is not as fast. This over here is an electrode artifact. Basically, this particular common electrode, which is T6 over here, has got a problem. It needs to be stuck a little better, right? And this also looks grossly abnormal. This is also absolutely normal. This is a beautiful example of a sleep EEG where we're seeing K complexes. So these are what we call as sleep spindles. And this large waveform before is a vertex wave. Combination of these two is called as a K complex. This is also fantastic. This is a patient who is drowsy, just going into sleep. Some of us over here are also a little drowsy. So if you're recording an EEG and we tap over here like this, knock on the table, that slight arousal will cause this complex to be seen on the EEG. We can do it during recording. We can just knock on the table, then you'll start seeing these kind of recordings, right? This is seen in stage 1 and stage 2 of sleep. So what is the utility of EEG? We use it mainly for epilepsy characterization, primary, secondary, generalized, focal epilepsies, epilepsy type in electroclinical syndromes, epileptogenic zone for surgery. So irritative zone we find out from looking at the interictal epileptiform discharges, and the ictal onset zone is if we capture an EEG seizure. So there we can tell what is the scalp EEG onset zone. We can find patients who are encephalopathic but actually having non-convulsive seizures by doing an EEG. EEG is an important part of the polysomnogram in sleep studies. Encephalopathy is also EEG can be useful. Brain death, it is not necessary, but it is an additional tool that can be used. And there are some people working on brain-computer interfaces also, including in VIT as well. And this is a part of area which Prabhakar and a few of our bioengineering people are also interested in. So this is an abnormal EEG. This is a child with absent seizures. It is a generalized epilepsy, but you can see that even in a generalized epilepsy, there is a frontal dominance. It is more frontally dominant. It is a spike and wave. Spike and wave. It's also called a spike and dome. It's a very clearly generalized, very monomorphic, but it slows down towards the end and stops as abruptly as it started. So this is an absence seizure, children with absence epilepsies. This is, we are seeing a complex, a broad complex with very high amplitude, and then suppressed for a while, and again a broad complex. This broad complex is broader than 1 second, and then for several seconds, 3 to 4 seconds, we are not seeing any complexes at all. This is subacute sclerosing panencephalitis, SSPEEG. This is an EEG which itself becomes almost diagnostic. This is triphasic waves seen in encephalopathy, hepatic encephalopathy, almost any encephalopathy we can see it. It has also got certain EEG characteristics. This is a patient with phenobarb toxicity. The phenobarb poisoning can come in with burst suppression. So we're seeing bursts. These are, what is the difference from the SSP? These are small, narrow complexes, unlike that which had a broad complex. These are narrow complexes in bursts and then followed by periods of suppression. This we can also see when we are doing EEG, when we are trying to see if our thiopentone has reached its adequate level, and during treatment of seizures in the ICU. And this is a EEG seizure in the during a record. What they have done is what is done over here is that the time thing is shortened, so 10, 15, 20, 25 seconds. As the time is going, we are seeing changes in both the amplitude, the morphology, and the distribution of the electrical activity. And these three things are the hallmarks for an EEG seizure. So to summarize, what does a normal EEG mean? Does it mean that the patient does not have epilepsy? Obviously not. Now we know that. So patient may have epilepsy. What we are trying to say is that there were no definite abnormalities that were picked up from the scalp with the given set of electrodes during the period of recording is what a normal EEG means. Now what does an abnormal EEG mean? Does the patient have epilepsy? It doesn't mean that. Each report has a different meaning. Encephalopathy, EEG because of slow. Fast EEGs you can see on certain medicines. So people on benzodiazepines can sometimes have a frontal beta rhythms. So you can have transients also, but a transients again can be artifacts, benign variants. You can have intractal epileptiform discharges, which can be seen even in normal individuals as high as 3%. If you see an electrographic seizure, even if you see an electrographic seizure, it does not necessarily mean that the patient has epilepsy. Why is that? Even if you see an electrographic seizure, it does not necessarily mean that the patient has epilepsy. What do I mean by that? Because epilepsy is a tendency for recurrent seizures. Just seeing one seizure does not mean, just like suppose somebody has hyponatremia and develops a seizure, doesn't mean that the patient has got epilepsy. Epilepsy is a tendency for recurrent seizures. So epilepsy is always a clinical diagnosis. It can be supported by EEG. EEG can help us to characterize focal versus generalized. It can help us to localize further if we are trying to do some epilepsy surgery and all. It is diagnostic in certain conditions, but EEG is a very useful tool. But because of various factors, how it is used, it depends always on the clinical context. So I'm ending over here. The next discussion can either be on the signal processing aspect of how we use the filters and the amplifiers to improve the signal noise ratio, or we can go on to nerve conductions and EMG. You can decide and let me know later as well. I can take questions on this, on any aspect of this.
Thank you, sir, for making EEG quite simple and making us orient. I think this is the first kind of lecture I think we had on EEG. Thank you. Any questions and any comments?
As an MD, as a general medicine, what are the common things that in common EEGs that we usually see?
So So those are the last EEGs that I showed. So the important ones are these, to be able to make out what is a blink reflex. So this is a typical blink reflex, the sudden downward deflection in the frontal leads. So that is one. The next thing is this one, where you are seeing spikes in the temporal lobe, and the remaining are these. So this is a classic EEG of absence epilepsy. This is also the frequency is also actually fixed, 3 hertz. In the juvenile myoclonic epilepsies, they tend to be faster. It can be 4 to 6 hertz. Pediatrics will see slower rhythms like this, where we call it as atypical absence, and often associated with syndromes which are called as epileptic encephalopathies. These are children who may have an underlying structural defect as well. We call as the Lennox-Gastaut syndromes. And this is a classical EEG, SSPE, which we are not seeing as much now as we used to see some years back. This is SSPE is related to the measles infection in early childhood, and it is thought to be related to a mutated virus. SSPE as a condition also has a velar connection. The first international conference on SSP and related disorders was held in Vellore in 1992, and a book came out with the contents of and the discussions and lectures that took place at that time, which was there in the neuro library at that time. So SSP now, of course, we don't use the EEG for diagnosis. We do the anti-measles antibody. We look at the titers in the CSF and in the serum to be able to diagnose SSP. But in resource-poor situations, a simple EEG in a given clinical context will almost always give us the diagnosis. The only thing is that as the patient worsens, the EEG pattern becomes less synchronized, and the EEG will not be as typical. And also in very early stages, SSP in the early stages will be just having some behavioral changes alone. So this can happen in the adolescents. We also have patients coming in, adults also, with SSP. This is an EEG pattern that you'll be seeing frequently, patients in W ward, almost anywhere in the medicine wards also. Encephalopathy, the most classic one is hepatic encephalopathy. There are ways to recognize this. It's called as a triphasic wave. There are 3 phases to the wave. And this is the burst suppression pattern that we look for in the ICU when we are doing thiopentone, giving thiopentone for refractory status epilepticus. And if we see this in somebody who has come to the casualty, we can suspect phenobarb overdose. And very rarely we will see an EEG seizure as well. So these are the important patterns on EEG. But EEG is much more than pattern recognition. There's a science to it. There's a little bit of interest. Those who are interested can go further into this.
Wow, phenomenal.
Yes. So many times in OPD we have patients with pseudo seizures, and we send them for induction. And what exactly is done? And
for pseudo seizures, what we are doing is we are doing a video EEG, what we are trying to elicit over there is that the patient has an event which it does not cause any change on the scalp EEG. So then we say that this patient's event is not a true seizure. There are certain caveats to that, but in general it is helpful, because not all seizures, ictal events, can be picked up on the scalp. But generally we'll see some change. Even if we do not see a classic EEG seizure like this, we might see some slowing or something. Ultimately, suppose something is very deep inside and the dipole does not reflect on the scalp, we may not be able to see it. It has to, the concept of like a seizure, when does a seizure become symptomatic? When do we see the symptoms of a seizure? Like we have these complex partial seizures, no? So they can have different types of symptoms during a seizure. So we have to imagine the electrical discharge is starting from some place and then spreading along the surface of the brain. So when it reaches symptomatic or eloquent areas of the brain, we will see symptoms. otherwise we may not see any symptoms at all. Not all parts of the cortex are symptomatic. Similarly, we have areas which are available for the scalp EEG. For certain types of seizures, we actually have to have either a magnetoencephalogram or we have to have invasive EEGs to pick up certain rare types of EEGs. But for majority of the patients, what we are trying to do is we take a video as well as the EEG and show that the patient has had these kind of movements, and during which time the EEG was absolutely normal, and therefore this is not a true seizure, it is a pseudo seizure. It is in video EEG centers, it is for doing a prolonged video telemetry EEG, it is the most common indication for video EEG. Because sometimes some pseudo seizures can be very difficult to pick up. And one more confounding factor is that 30-40% of patients with true seizures can have pseudo seizures as well. And why does that become a problem? Because we need to, when we are trying to, you know, we can't just keep going up on anticonvulsants. We have to find out if there is a combination of true and pseudo seizures, in which case the treatment changes. So before we label somebody as refractory seizures, we sometimes have to, if we have a clinical doubt, we have to get a video EEG done. The duration of the video EEG can vary. We have, of course, up to 24 hours, but when we move to Kanigapuram, we'll be able to do even 7 days video EEG as well.
Any other questions or comments? Sir, in OPD, first setting ECG, EEG is there, and 2-4 hour telemetry is there. So when we see a patient with first time seizures, what test we order?
Yeah, so first time seizures, this information we have from data that was collected in the UK in the 1980s, and what they found was somebody with a first seizure, and we do one EEG, even if the patient has epilepsy, the chances that the EEG will pick up something is only 50%. If you do a second EEG, it goes up to around 80-85%. If you do a third EEG, it reaches around 90% or so. So doing frequent, repeating the EEGs can increase the pickup chance. This is from data from the 1980s. But now we know that we approach it differently. Suppose somebody has a single seizure. Even today also seen. So in fact, he's not had a seizure at all. The only thing that he had was in 2010. He while eating, he dropped his plate. And they did an EEG, found an abnormality, he was put on valproate. And he took for 3 years, he had no further events, and it was stopped. Then in 2014, overnight he had two more episodes. He woke up with some jerks, he didn't have a full generalized seizure, but he was having some jerks. So in this kind of situation, the history itself is conclusive. EEG is helpful. This is myoclonus. What he's having is myoclonus. At 2010, he was around 19 years of old age. So this is juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. On a small dose of valproate for 3 years, he had no further episodes. After 2014, he's been on medications and he had no further episodes after that again. Right? So this is classic. Even without an EEG, we can say that this is juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. So the utility of an EEG depends on the setting. So those things that we read about, that the EEG picks up this much in this and, first EEG, second EEG and all, is from older data where they looked at all types of epilepsy together. Whereas now we are more interested in, and those are the times when in the Western world, even now also, they don't recommend an imaging for one seizure. Whereas for us, because of the chance, because we have so much neuropsychosis over here, we tend to do some sort of an imaging even if they've had a definite single seizure as well. We tend to do, unless the pattern is as specific as something like this, which is, you know, clearly myoclonus. So now we tend to tailor our request depending on the history that we get. And so 1 hour EEG is enough. The telemetry EEGs were designed more for trying to figure out whether it's a focal versus a generalized epilepsy. When we want to do a sleep deprivation and capture an EEG, or want to look for a pseudo seizure, routine EEG means it's done for 20 minutes. A routine EEG will not be enough for that. But if you just want to have somebody with a single seizure, you want to do one EEG, that's a routine EEG, what we call as the first visit EEG is adequate.
Does a patient being on an anti-epileptic medicine brings any changes to the EEG or?
Yeah. So the spikes are dependent on, so I didn't cover that. So the spikes are actually sudden depolarizations taking place in multiple neurons together. These are also postsynaptic potentials, and they're taking place synchronized across large areas to be able to pick up on the scalp. Right. So these spikes are not going to be suppressed by medications. These spikes are not going to be suppressed by medications. This is an important concept. So then why do we do an EEG even we are wanting to stop medicines? Because what we are hoping for is that the patient had a time-related epilepsy, that his tendency for spikes has gone away with age. So there are certain childhood epilepsies which are limited to certain age. So the developing brain at different times, for example, the developing brain at different times, certain epilepsies are only seen at that time. A good example of that is, we have this epilepsy called as benign epilepsy with centrotemporal spikes. It's also called as benign Rolandic epilepsy. So this is an epilepsy which, for majority of the children, by the time they reach the age of 8, they will no longer need medications. In fact, it's so benign that even if the child has these nocturnal seizures, we don't even need to give an anticonvulsant if the family is, So what changes with time and why we repeat again? All this comes from that Manchester data of the 1980s. So that time it was unselected patients, all types of epilepsy, all pulled together, and therefore they came up with these things that if the patient is seizure free for 2 years or 3 years, you do an EEG and the EEG is normal, you can taper off the anticonvulsant. Actually, all these things have to be individualized. There's no one size fits all for everybody.
So we can't actually make out the effect of medication on the EEG. We can't actually be doing that. So the last question is to the house. How many of you would like to have the next session again on EEG? Would that be too advanced? Like you said that about the...
Yeah, so this will be on signal processing, on how we use the filters, what we actually look like, how easy it is to make these muscle spikes by just changing the filters. It can look just like an epileptiform discharge by inappropriate use of the filters. So that is one way. The other thing will be to shift to the next topic on your syllabus, which will be EMG NCV and introduction to that. I think that probably will be better.
So maybe that extra topic you said.
Yeah.
I think there are only about 10 or 15 people. We'll have a smaller session for that.
Yeah.
But a big session for the whole faculty and all PGs could be EMG NCV. Is that a general consensus? Okay. I'm not saying we can't have the next session on EEG by sir. But that we'll have it as a smaller group for people interested. And the next talk will be on EMG and CV. And I must thank him. He's also a volunteer to take approach to many neurological conditions. So he said one he will do whenever we ask is approach to multiple cranial nerve palsies. So we'll try to have, thank again Mohan for organizing this. Let's give Mohan a hand. So he's always hiding somewhere in the back. So we'll try to have more frequent DOMAPs at least during this time, because it's nice to have these academic sessions as long as we do social distancing. We also have a hall upstairs in case anybody feels that we're not doing social distancing. So let's give Vivek a great
Thanks.
Hand.
Thank you,
Thank you so much, Vivek. Thanks. So next, our next session will be on EMG and CV.
and then after that on approach to cranial nerves.
Yes.
Or do you want to do cranial nerves and then... So, okay, so we'll do EMG and CV next and then we'll do approach to multiple cranial nerves. Thank you again, Vivek. Come join us.